That's the truth. All right? So tonight, 7 p.m., the Mark of the Beast. But right now, we got a topic entitled Beast Mode. We're going to be looking at what the Bible teaches in regards to the United States in Bible prophecy. So before we go any further, what should we do?
Pray.
All right, let us pray, my friends. Father in heaven, again, not to be redundant, not to be just going through the motions, but Father, we sincerely recognize that in attempting to rightly divide your word of truth and to understand it, we dare not take a step further without asking for your guidance and your leadership. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon me, Lord, that this may be clear, that it may be communicated with power, with boldness, in such a way, Lord, that it draws us to be excited, to be on fire for what's coming, what's happening, what we're seeing before our eyes unfold in the world that we're living in. Father, we know that time is short, and may today's message just be an even more clear indication that Jesus is coming soon. So draw us, Lord, a light of fire in us, God, and awaken us to the times that we're living, we ask in Jesus' holy name. Amen. 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 Before we can understand the role that the United States plays in Bible prophecy, we first need to study the first beast of Revelation chapter 13. Now, we have already touched on many of the verses that we see in the beginning half or the first half of Revelation 13. But we just want to do a quick review for some of us who may not have been here for that presentation, and perhaps maybe there's someone watching at home today who has never heard this presentation before, and we want to be clear on the identity of the first beast of Revelation 13, because if we are not sure as to the identity of the first beast of Revelation, then we for sure cannot be accurate in our discovery of the identity of the second beast of Revelation 13. Also, if we're not sure about the identity of the first beast of Revelation 13, then we can absolutely not know what the mark of the beast is. Because the mark of the beast, which we'll be discussing tonight, the mark of the beast happens to be the mark of the first beast of Revelation 13. So we're going to jump right into the scripture. And so what I'm going to do is read through, maybe not all of the scriptures, but all of the major ones here. And then we're going to bring up just some general identifications that we're going to pull from these texts. And then it's going to give us a very clear, we're going to come to a clear conclusion as to who this is. It has to be only one institution. Revelation chapter 13, verse 1, John is in vision. He's seeing this vividly in his mind, as almost like a movie is rolling in his mind. He's seeing all of these scenes and all of this is happening, these events happening very clearly and vividly in his mind. And he sees this and he says, "Then I stood up on the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rising up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and on his horns 10 crowns, and on his heads a blasphemous name. Now the beast which I saw was like a leopard, and his feet were like the feet of a bear, and his mouth like the mouth of a lion. The dragon gave him his power, his throne, and great authority. And he was given a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies, and he was given authority to continue for 42 months. Then he opened his mouth in blasphemy against God to blaspheme his name, his tabernacle, and those who dwell in heaven. It was granted to him to make war with the saints and to overcome them. And authority was given him over every tribe, tongue, and nation." And then we go back to verse 3. We missed verse 3 for a reason. It says, "And I saw one of his heads as if it had been mortally wounded, and his deadly wound was healed." I saved that one for last, because it helps put in the proper time sequence of things, who this beast is in the transition from the first beast to the second beast. But let us look at the identifications of this beast that we just read in these verses of Revelation 13. Number one, notice how this first beast comes out of the sea. And we have determined that the waters, the seas in which this beast and this harlot of Revelation 17 is rising up from or sitting upon, we know that this is mass population. It's a large, massively populated area. So lots of people. It's the people that, again, give their allegiance to this power that brings about and gives it its great authority. Of course, we know that it says that the enemy, the devil, the dragon, gave him his authority. But of course, we know that in the devil giving him the authority, the people have to support that to give it its strength and its power, its rulership. And so the people play a major role in that sense. Number two, this is a blasphemous power. It's blaspheming God. And we learned what that was in one of our previous presentations. That it would reign for 42 prophetic months. 42 months. How many months are there in a biblical, how many days are there in a biblical month? There's 30 days in a biblical month. And so if you multiply 42 times 30, how many days do you get? 1,260 days, which we know the year-day principle applied there, it comes to 1,260 years. So that reigning for 42 prophetic months means that this power would reign for 1,260 years. It's also a persecuting power, as it is seen there persecuting the saints. And it's also given world dominion. All the world wonders after this beast, all whose names are not written in the Lamb's Book of Life, is giving worship and allegiance and honor to this system. And then finally, number six, notice how it says it receives a deadly wound. And I have in parentheses there 1798, because there is no doubt, my friends, I mean, most biblical scholars and theologians have come to this conclusion. They're not even Seventh-day Adventists, and they've come to this conclusion that it can only be one power, one earthly authority, and that, of course, is the Roman papal church state that fits the description of this first beast of Revelation chapter 13. It is the Roman Catholic system, and I want to emphasize that. We're not here to throw people under the bus, because God loves His people, does He not? Does God have people in this Roman Catholic system? He has people that are living up to all the light that they know, that He's leading and guiding, and that in the appropriate time, when the message goes out to them, come out of her, my people, they will, because they're following the Holy Spirit. So does God have people in Babylon? Yes, but He will call them out. It's just a matter of time. But this Roman papal system, this Catholic system, is the only institution on the earth that can fit the biblical description. And as we saw there, In verse 3, where it says there was a mortal wound or a deadly wound given to the system, we know that the papacy reigned supreme from 538 A.D. to 1798 A.D. Now, I want you to notice the time frame here. As the deadly wound is being given to the papacy, remember the papacy was shut down. It was temporarily given, it's a political authority was temporarily taken away from the papacy. The Pope was arrested in 1798, in which he would die in prison. And Napoleon Bonaparte, the emperor or the great president or prime minister or leader of France at that time, he would steal that away from the Catholic Church, because he's not going to compete with the papacy as another political authority. He took it away from him, therefore delivering a deadly wound to the papal system. This is happening in the year 1798. Now notice the time frame, because this is crucial. Because by the time you get to the end of the description of this first beast, now you come to Revelation 13 verse 11. And now we see this second beast coming into play. It says, "Then I saw another beast coming up out of the earth. And he had two horns like a lamb and spoke like a dragon." Notice the time frame here. As the first beast is going down, 1798, there's another beast coming up out of the earth around this same time. What one nation out of all the nations in the world, in existence, in the history of mankind, is coming into world-recognized dominant existence around that same time? It's the only country that can fit the description, and that is none other than the United States of America. Now, I'm going to prove that to you by looking again at a few identifications just from verse 11 alone. I mean, verse 11 is packed with a lot of identifications if you just study it clearly. Number one, notice how the second beast is coming up out of the earth. Where did the first beast come up from? The sea. And the sea represents what? Lots of people. Mass population. So now in opposite of the sea, you have the earth. What would the earth represent? The earth represents a sparsely populated area. In other words, an area in which there's not large mass population. It's almost uninhabited. Does the United States fit that description? Did we become a nation in an area that was already established by a large populated group of people? Or did the United States come up out of the earth in the sense that it was established almost from nothing? That's it. The United States, of course, came up from the earth, meaning that it was established from in a very sparsely populated area. Yes, there were Native Americans here, but my friends, if you do your historical research, you'll find that while there were Native American presence here, that they were far and few. There was not as many Native Americans as you might think in comparison to the population today. There were a few thousand here, a few thousand there along the coast, but most of the Native Americans were inland, I wouldn't say westward into Midwestern United States, because there were a lot along the eastern coast, but they were sparsely populated all throughout this land. And actually, it's interesting because many of the areas that we first established when the nation was rising up and they were coming in and they were, you know, discovering and exploring the land, many of the large, you know, millions of acres of land, they went for, you know, hundreds of thousands of acres before they finally discovered even a Native American. And so this was very, very sparsely populated in many areas. And so it's why we see this beast coming up out of the earth. And so notice, did the United States rise somewhere in and around 1798 as a nation? Notice 1776, we released the Declaration of Independence. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. These individuals were breaking away. They were establishing their freedom and their independence from Europe, from Great Britain. And in this case, it was between the years 1776 and 1798 that this nation was gradually growing into the world-dominant, recognized nation that it is today. You'll also notice something about this second beast that is quite different than the first beast. The first beast had 10 horns. What do those horns represent? It represents a significant kingdom or powerful entity within a country, right? And so it's interesting that upon each one of the horns of the first beast, there were crowns. But on this second beast, while it has two horns, it has no crowns. Does that tell us something about the nature of this nation? Notice how all, historically, how all of the European nations, of, you know, the nations of Western Europe, they're all ran in this time, you know, 1798 before, they're all ran and dominated by some type of kingly or queenly monarch. Some type of royal monarch of some kind. But was the United States founded on the rulership of a king or a queen? Not on a crown, but rather, obviously, it was what we know today as a representative democracy. In the sense that in the old days, in the country where the king and the queen ruled, it was what the king and the queen said, period. It was like a dictatorship. Versus nowadays, we live in a country that was established on the principles, many different principles of freedom and many different principles of democracy, in which now we can actually say that we live in a country where the way it's supposed to function is that the people have the power, the people elect representatives, and it's a representative democracy in the sense that the people tell their representatives what they want in the form of voting, and the legislation is passed by a body of people, not dictated by one or two or three people. That's how the United States was founded. Also, I find it interesting that John said, I've always pictured this in my mind, it's quite interesting. He said that this beast has two horns like a lamb. How many of you have ever seen a lamb with horns? Anyone in here ever seen a, I'm talking about a lamb, not a sheep. A lamb with, what's a lamb? A lamb is a baby sheep. In fact, did you know that in every single instance that John mentions Jesus Christ as the Lamb, by the way, I think it's like 28 times, 28 or 29 times in the book of Revelation that you find the word Lamb mentioned. In I think it's 28 times, and 27 of those 28 times, it's in direct reference to Jesus Christ. And it's also interesting that at every single time, including this one, and where it's describing this second beast, the second nation, and every single time he uses the Greek word arnion. Now, again, sometimes we hear ministers talking, Greek words and Hebrew words, and it's like, I don't care about no Greek or Hebrew. But sometimes it's important to dig a little deeper to determine what it is, that is actually being said so you can get a better understanding. Because sometimes things don't translate very well from one language to another. And so he used the Greek word arnion. Now that's significant because if you go look in the Greek language, the general word for lamb or sheep that would be used in the Greek language is the word emnos. For instance, I think it's in John chapter 1, verse 29, where John the Baptist sees Jesus coming, remember? And he says, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." Well, right there in the Greek, John, in that book, used the word emnos. Behold the emnos of God, the Lamb. It's the general word used for lamb or sheep. But it's quite interesting that in the book of Revelation, he did not see Jesus in vision. In his visions, he did not see Jesus as just some general emnos. Every single time he uses the word arnion, you know what arnion means? It's a baby lambkin. In other words, it's a little baby pet sheep. Has anybody in here ever held a little baby lamb? You ever held a little baby? I'm talking about one of those little tiny ones. I don't even know if they have them. Yeah, they're just like, there's a little body, little bitty baby tiny limbs. I mean, they're just lifeless in your arm. They're just so cute. You just want to hold them. Oh, have you ever read the book of Mice and Men? I would have to be careful. I'd end up being a Lenny with that one. I just love little cute animals. I pray for me with little cute animals. Anyways, that was a literature reference. If you haven't read with Mice and Men, then just don't even think about what I just said. The Lamb of God. But notice, two horns, and he uses the word arnion, like a baby pet lamb. How many of you have ever seen a baby pet lamb with horns? You haven't. But for whatever reason, here's the thing. He saw two horns on this beast, this animal, but there was something lamb-like about it. So that's why the identification here, number four, is that it's like a lamb. There's something about this country that's like a lamb. And being that the other 27 out of the 28 times that he mentions the arnion, the lamb, and that it's in direct reference to Christ, it's quite interesting that there very well may be, and tell me if I'm going in the right direction here, that there's something about this country in its very nature, in its very origin, within its very legislative beliefs, that can appear to be lamb-like, Christ-like. I don't think anyone is going to deny the fact that this nation, at least in its origin and in its original doctrines and in its original manuscripts and its original theories and the mentality of the founding fathers and what's expressed on our money and what's expressed on our monuments and in all of the memoirs. And if you read all of the old documents, you can't get away from the fact that this country appeared to be at one time very Christ-like. It almost appeared to be a Christian nation. But those two horns, remember, every horn symbolizes something within a greater empire. Remember, Rome was the great empire, but it had 10 horns. It had 10 smaller powers that ruled within its empire. Well, same thing with the United States. The United States was built on two powerful leading principles, two powerful leading entities. And of course, in the great, if you don't have the Great Controversy in your library, get it. If you don't have the book, The Great Controversy, you need it in your library. You need to read it. Don't just let it sit in your library. Pull it out. Read it. It's a powerful book. But notice that it's a great historical book as well. Communicates a lot of history. And notice what it says here on page 441. It says, "And he had two horns like a lamb. The lamb-like horns indicate youth innocence, and gentleness, fitly representing the character of the United States when presented to the prophet as coming up in what year? 1798. Now tie that to the book, The Spirit of Prophecy, Volume 4, page 277, again, establishing the history of the United States. It says, and the lamb-like horns, emblems of innocence and gentleness, well represent the character of our government, notice, as expressed in its two fundamental principles, republicanism and Protestantism. So what are those two horns that this nation was built upon? Republicanism and Protestantism. I can tell you as a history major, that is absolutely accurate. Now, when we say republicanism, let's not mistake that as the Republican Party. Okay, take that idea, put it in a little box, go throw it in the bottom of Norfolk Lake. It's not going to do you any good. This is not what it's talking about when it says republicanism. She's not talking about the Republican Party. She's talking about the principle of government, the idea that the power is in the hands of the people, that the people, now it's by the power of the people that the legislation is passed and that the legislation comes about and that our government is founded upon the principles that is voted upon and set forth by the body of the people, not just a few people, like an oligarchy or some type of monarchy or dictatorship of some kind. That's why even in our great Constitution, in the Bill of Rights that was put forward in the 1780s, as this nation was growing into the dominant nation that it would become, it makes it very clear, Congress shall make no law respecting the establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. Praise God for this freedom. Amen. Praise God that we can stay here, we can stand here today, sit here today, and worship God in freedom and with the liberty knowing that no one's going to bust through the door with guns and blow us down because we are worshiping God. You can't believe such a thing would happen in America, but it happens in many, many other countries. And don't think for a moment that times may not get bad enough that we may see something like that. That's why it's important, my friends, that we stand for liberty and freedom. Amen. This is not just an American thing. It's a godly thing. Amen. Our God is a God of freedom. He lets you freely worship however you want, whenever you want, whoever you want. He doesn't even take that freedom away from you to go worship Buddha if you want to. He doesn't take that freedom away from you if you want to go worship Krishna or Confucius or all the other confusion gods out there. Hey, you want to do that? You want to follow them? Our God loves you so much that He will not remove that freedom from you. But I pray and hope that you choose to worship the one true God, Jesus Christ. So there's no doubt, no one is going to look into the history of this nation and say that there's not a lamb-like factor about it. I mean, my goodness, when you look into the Declaration of Independence, you know, our very money and God we trust, the Pledge of Allegiance, what does it say? I pledge of allegiance to the flag, to the United States of America, unto the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Our Pledge of Allegiance. Even in our leaders' memoirs, journals and speeches, monuments and buildings. How many of you have ever been to Washington, D.C.? Have you ever been to Washington, D.C., the capital of our nation? My goodness, my wife and I took our class there a couple of years ago before COVID. We had a wonderful opportunity to go to Washington, D.C., so we took her whole class up there on a field trip for a couple of days to just go and through some of the museums and just take in the sights and, you know, take in our nation's capital. It was a history. I was helping to teach history at that time at the school, and we were able to, you know, take in the history of our nation. And I tell you, as I'm going by, you cannot deny the fact that there at one time, at least at some point, there was something Christian about this nation. The presence was there. The evidence is there. Even if you don't agree with them, and I'm going to say some things in just a few moments to clarify this, but, you know, even in our, like, for instance, all of our major founding fathers of this nation, while they were not perfect men, and while some of them made decisions that make me sick, when you read about the history and some of the things that they said and done, I sometimes question. But at the end of the day, you can't change the fact that even in their great memoirs and their speeches, they make it very clear that they were believers in the God of the Bible. In fact, notice our very first president of the United States in his farewell speech to this nation, in his very last speech as he was stepping down from president, notice what he says. He says, let us, speaking to the American people, He says, let us with caution indulge the supposition that morality can be maintained without religion. He says, whatever may be conceded to the influence of refined education on minds of peculiar structure, reason and experience both forbid us to expect that national morality can prevail in exclusion of religious principle. Now, obviously, our first president was a very educated man in the way that he wrote. We might call him a modern Paul. Sometimes in the way that he wrote things, maybe won't make a lot of sense to some of us common folk. But nonetheless, when you study what he just wrote, basically what he just said is in the future of this nation, as the first president, he says, I'm telling you in my farewell speech, if we want this nation to remain a moral nation, we cannot remove religion from its experience. The moment we remove religion is the moment that national morality will plunder. Have we seen a little bit of that in our country as of late? Does it seem like we're a little bit different of a country than we were maybe a few years ago? Notice John Adams, second president of the United States. He says, suppose a nation in some distant region should take the Bible for their only law book and every member should regulate his conduct by the precepts thereof exhibited. What a utopia. What a paradise would this region be. Amen. Samuel Adams, he said, don't mistake this by the drink. This is the real person. Samuel Adams, we may with one heart and voice humbly implore his gracious and free pardon through Jesus Christ, supplicating his divine aid, and above all to cause the religion of Jesus Christ in its true spirit to spread far and wide till the whole earth shall be filled with his glory. I mean, these were not perfect men, but they were men of faith. They believed in the Bible. They believed in Jesus. And they established as leaders of this country that they wanted the future of this country to be that of a Christian nation. They tried. Notice this. Patrick Henry. You know Patrick Henry? Give me liberty or give me death, he said. All right? Notice what he wrote here. He says, being a Christian, it is, notice, is a character which I prize far above all this world has or can boast. Righteousness alone can exalt America as a nation. Whoever thou art, remember this, and in thy sphere practice virtue thyself, and encourage it in others. All right. First Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of the United States of America, John Jay. This is what he wrote. Providence has given to our people the choice of their rulers. And it is the duty as well as the privilege and interest of our Christian nation. Uh-oh. What did he say? What kind of nation did he consider it? Christian nation. To select and prefer Christians for their rulers. Even on the, it's powerful, even on the 34th Congress in 1856, in the House of Representatives of the United States of America, they actually read this as they were praying on the Congress floor. This is what they said. The great, vital, and conservative element in our system is the belief of our people in the pure doctrines and the divine truths of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so many of our founding fathers, including people like John Quincy Adams, Alexander Hamilton, John Hancock, James Madison, George Mason, John Morton, Noah Webster, all of these men were devout Christians who let out in this country. But my friends, let me just pause for a moment. I want to be fair. We have to address the elephant in the room. That while I still believe, I'm a proud American, and I love my country. I'm a good old American boy through and through. The Bible makes it very clear. But while there's something lamb-like about this nation, that there's also something dragon-like about it. Which is why, as a history major in college, as I was studying much in depth of the history of this nation, because my emphasis in college was on American history, while we have men and women in this country who did all that they could to express the Christian in themselves, the Christ in themselves, we have to also recognize that there was a dragon at work also in the hearts of many of the men and women in this country. For there are things in the history of this country that as an American, I'm ashamed of. I'm not proud of. I despise it. The oppression of people, the slavery of people, the hurt and the despair of others by men who are power hungry and full of demons. That also is the history of this nation. And we have to recognize the fact that while Jesus Christ was working hard to lead in some of these men to bring about morality in this country, there was also a dragon equally working to cause this nation to fall under demonic principles and ideology. And you know there's been, I mean, my friends, I think about it. You know for a fact that this nation has started to speak more like a dragon. Because check this out, 1955, I looked up the statistics. 92% of America in 1955 was Christian. Did you know that? Look at the stats of this. 92% of America was Christian. And notice, 70% of that 92% was Protestant. Only 22% was Catholic. Only 4% was Jewish. 2% was other in the sense that they weren't Christian or Catholic. They were other religions like, you know, Buddhism, Hinduism, you know, Islam. And only 3% of our country at that time claimed to be none at all. In other words, atheist or agnostic or, you know, not believe in any deity at all. Now that's 1955. So let's go back here because our fifth identification is that this nation would speak as a dragon. Have we been seeing a little bit of that? My friends, oh my goodness. If you have been awake and living, if you have a pulse and some sense, then you have seen the evidence just in this country. Many of us here, you know, I'll just tell you, I'm 33 years old. Oh, I will be 33 years old in June. Oh, listen to him. Oh, that baby. Look at him. He's such a baby. He's just a young baby up there. I can tell you in my short time of living, I have seen our country change a lot. But some of y'all, more mature folk, it's been around a little bit longer. Y'all can tell it even more. Now, if I were to ask you, what was the greatest time in your life? Well, if you could go back to a decade and choose a decade in your life that you thought, man, these were the glory days, which decade would that be? The 50s, the 60s, the 70s. You know, everybody's got their little decade, right? But you know good and well, since your little glorious decade until now, it's a different America. It's a different America. It's a different country. Notice Revelation 13, 11, then I saw another beast coming up out of the earth and he had two horns like a lamb and spoke like a... All right, you ready for the stats? I looked these up. They're a little ugly. Here we go. Let's compare. Now, if 1955, let's just say in respect of this country's history and the more than 200 years that this country has existed, okay? 1955 wasn't too long ago. Some of you remember the year 1955. Okay? It wasn't too long ago in respect to the entire history of this country. So just in comparing the stats from 1955 to 2000, as early as 2020, or as recent as 2020, notice this. In 1955, 92% of America was Christian. Guess what it is in 2020? 68%. Now don't get too caught up in that number because it gets worse. Notice how 70% of the 92% in 1955 were Protestant. Today, only 37% of the 68% are Protestant. Notice how the Catholics are holding strong at their 22. But let me tell you something, that 22% is much greater than it was in 1955. You're talking about millions, millions, millions. Notice Jewish were 4%. In 2020, it's 2%. But you'll notice here in the middle of 2020, there's a 9% and it says nonspecific. You didn't have that in 1955. In 1955, if someone would have come up to you and you said, what church do you go to? Oh, I'm just a nonspecific Christian. I just don't really believe anything about anyone or anybody. I just believe in Jesus and that's it. You would have looked at those people probably in 1955 and said, that's weird. Them folk are weird. Everybody belonged to a church in 1955. You may not have agreed doctrinally, you may not have been at the same church, but everybody belonged to some kind of branch of Christianity in 1955. Now today, notice, 9% of our nation's population says they believe in Jesus, but they aren't really specific about what they believe in regards to Jesus. And of course, you see other there, where it says, 2% in 1955 were either, Buddhist, Islam, Hindu, or any other kind of religion. Well, it's now 6%, and here's the one that just really gets me. Get this next one. In 1955, 3% of the population was either atheist, agnostic, or of no belief at all. Now today, it's nearly a quarter of our nation. One-fourth of America, nearly, is either atheist, agnostic, or of no belief at all. My friends, has this nation begun to speak like a dragon? Oh, it gets worse. Let me show you some. Not to be doom and gloom, but just to give you the facts. All right, this is from a poll as recent as 2018 that shows less than half of Americans, 49%, believe that all the Ten Commandments are still relevant today. Okay? In fact, I went and found this Kelton research. Notice what they did. You can go online and find the results of this Kelton research that was done. Check this out. A survey by Kelton Research found 80% of American respondents could name the Big Mac's primary ingredient, 2 all-beef patties, but less than 6 in 10 knew the Ten Commandments, thou shalt not kill. This is your America. Your America. Less than half of the respondents, 45% to be exact, could recall the commandment, honor thy father and mother, but 62% of them knew the Big Mac has a pickle. And then this last one really gets me. Bobby and Peter, the least recalled names from the fictional Brady Bunch family, were remembered by 43% of respondents, topping the 34% who knew remember the Sabbath, and 29% recalling do not make false idols. When we know more knowledge about McDonald's Big Mac and more knowledge about the fictional characters, the Brady Bunch, than we do the Ten Commandments of the Lord, what kind of nation have we become? Certainly not that of a lamb, but more like a... All right. I even dug up some more statistics. This comes from multiple sources, by the way, that I pulled together as to find all of these calculations. But in 1960, the murders in 1960 were around 9,110. And by the time you get to 19 to 2020, it's 16,425 in 2019. But in 2020, there were over 19,000 murders in the United States of America. Rape, 17,190 in 1960. In 2020, 325,566 cases. Assault in 1960, 154,320. Today, 821,182. Theft, over 2 million cases. 2020, 5,807,981. And don't get me started on this next one. Lord, help me. In 1960, there was a record of 292 cases of abortions. But now today, worldwide, there's, now this is just America, by the way, 1 million, and they say plus. That's just in America each year. 1 million plus. But here's the thing. They put plus because there are so many abortions that are taken off the record that they don't know exactly the number. They only have over 1 million accounted for. But if you look worldwide, if you consider all the, this is not just America, but worldwide, there's more than 3,000 babies, unborn babies a day being aborted and murdered. Now, my friends, I didn't come here this morning to get all political and talk about Roe versus Wade or abortion or anything like that. I'll leave you with your little politics somewhere else. I don't want to discuss that. But what I do want to say is this. There is something in the Bible called the commandments of the Lord that says, thou shalt not murder. Amen. And we have all of these modern reasons today which people come to. And I'm going to throw it out there. I'm going to just say it. Women, they've come to the conclusion that it's their body and they can do what they want to with it. Again, I'm not going to get into all the politics about it. I'm just going to say this. At the end of the day, as Christians, amen. Now non-Christians, you expect that. Amen. But as Christians, we have to assume responsibility. And we have to take responsibility and say to ourselves, the child that I'm carrying, the Bible says that God knits them in his mother's womb. You know, we live in a day and age where science can put a little egg and some sperm cells in a little petri dish. And just a little while, it comes together. And before they go put that in a mother's body, I think what's it called, like in vitro or something. Before they put that little in back in, they can determine the sex of that baby. In its amoeba form, in its little cellular form. Now, how can they tell the sex of that baby that early on? They can do it. They can determine if it carries the X chromosome, the Y chromosome, all that. They can determine that. If they can determine that in a petri dish, you know what that means? God has already begun his work. Amen. And when you decide to take that, whatever reason, and I know that there's so many reasons, and I know I'm on a little tangent here, but I have to say my piece on this. When anyone, man or woman, comes to the conclusion that it's time to get rid of that, that it's my body and I can do what I want with it, you sure are, but you're also removing and taking away the choice from that living organism that God just created. What about that? And also take in consideration, it is your body as a woman to decide what you want to with it. But notice, there's a 50% chance that that little child that would have also been a woman, and you're taking away that decision from that woman. Amen. We've got to be careful, my friends. Pray for this. You expect non-Christians, you expect the world to do things like this. But when I hear Christians talking about murdering unborn babies, have mercy. Amen. Have mercy. Speaking as a dragon? I think so. In the 1950s and 60s, there were executive orders signed and sodomy laws that existed in establishing cultural principles against homosexuality. And my friends, I want to say this right here. I don't believe in the oppression of any kind of person. If someone wants to be homosexual, they want to be lesbian, gay, transgender, whatever, you know what? I'm still going to love them. I'm not going to go out and oppress them. I'm not going to go out there and persecute them for that. So I don't believe in that at all. But nonetheless, I'm giving you the history that at one time in our country, homosexuality as a nation was looked down upon. It was not accepted. It was looked at and seen as something morally wrong. Now, I don't agree with how many of those homosexual individuals in the 50s and the 60s and 70s were persecuted in the way that they were. I don't agree with that. But nonetheless, as a nation, our attitude towards it was that it's wrong. It's not right. Why? Because back in those days, 92% of the population was Christian and more than 70% were Protestant. And they are Bible-believing people, and therefore they came to the conclusion that homosexuality is an abomination. It's wrong. It's not right. Now, today, notice, recent polls show that more than 72% of American citizens believe that LGBTQ, the movement, might as well add all the other alphabets in there, LGBTQ movement is a great thing. I looked this up. These are real statistics. Do you realize you live in an America where more than 72% of the residents of America believe that it's okay for people to be homosexual, lesbian, gay, transgender, bi, whatever it is, all the rest of them. In 2020, when the recent census was taken, look at this, 11,343,000 Americans identified as lesbian, gay, or transgender. That's 4.5% of the population. And it's growing each and every day. Again, I want to make this clear for the world to hear. I have lesbian and gay friends. They're good friends of mine. I love them. We talk, we chat, we have fun. But we also have an understanding. They know my stance. They know I'm a Christian. I'm not going to oppress them. I'm not going to persecute them. I'm not going to find moments to say bad things about them and to cut them down. But they know that as a Christian where I stand. I'll let them know in 3 seconds. It's an abomination. You need to get your life right with the Lord. You need to bring your life in harmony with God's will for your life. You are a man. Be a man. Don't be out there laying with another man. You are a woman. Be a woman. Don't be out there laying with another woman. Because God says it's an abomination. But I still love my gay and lesbian friends. See, that's the thing. We, you know, as Christians, sometimes we got to check ourselves and our attitudes, because even though we may take what the world considers to be a very strong stance on these things, and we say, it's wrong, homosexuals are bad, and we may have all this, sometimes that attitude comes out in the way that we treat them. We've got to be careful, my friends. I don't know if Mountain Home Church has experienced having a gay or lesbian or transgender or anything coming through those doors, but when they do, love the mess out of them. Love them, right? There's nothing. Now, there are, okay, I'm going to say it very clearly. There are measurements in place in which, you know, for membership, obviously a person that's going to be dead set on living that lifestyle, biblically speaking and according to church manual and according to the Bible, we should not be inviting them in as members. But should we invite them into fellowship? Absolutely. Love the mess out of them. Witness to them in hopes that they will turn from their evil ways and live for Jesus Christ. That's how it should be done. We've got to learn to love our brothers and sisters. But yet, we still live in a day and age where it's not like yesteryear. Back in the day, you know, there's a song, a country song years ago. I always thought it was funny. I don't know why this just came to my mind, but there was a country song years ago that came out by Tim McGraw called Back When. And in the lyrics, he says, back when a Coke was a Coke and a hoe was a hoe. You know, he's talking about, you know, back when a Coke was a Coke in the sense of Coca-Cola. When you said a Coke, you're talking about a Coca-Cola. Today, when you're talking about Coke, you're talking about something you sniff, drugs. He says, you know, back then a hoe was an instrument you used for gardening, but now today it has a different meaning. You know, And he goes on to describe some other things. He's describing the fact that, you know, back then when I grew up, this is what this stuff meant. Nowadays, things are different. We live in a different world. And you know what? The truth of the matter is, it just shouldn't surprise us, because Isaiah prophesied that in the last days there would come a time. Notice, he says, woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who put darkness for light and light for darkness, who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Are we living in those times? Where it seems like all the things that we know are morally wrong, now it seems the world is just like, it's acceptable. And now you're persecuted if you don't like them. And all the things that you know are morally right, that are good because they're biblical, they're according to the character of the Almighty God, now the world says, no, that's hate. You're oppressing us. You're pushing your doctrines of evil Christianity upon us. This is the world we live in. You know what we've turned into? You know what we've entered into as a nation? Beast mode. Full on beast mode. We're no longer that little lamb. We are speaking 100% as a dragon. That's why Revelation chapter 13, verse 12 goes on to say, and he exercises all the authority of the first beast in his presence. Who's the first beast? Who's the first beast? I hear one person saying it. I'd like to hear at least a few more. Who's the first beast? The papacy. Notice, prophecy. This isn't my words. These are the words of the Almighty. He promises, he prophesies that this second beast, the United States, would exercise all the authority of the first beast in his presence and cause the earth and those who dwell in it to worship the first beast whose deadly wound was healed. Is the deadly wound healed yet? It's always a divide in the church on that, right? You have half the people's like, yes, 1929, it was healed. Actually, I'll tell you, my friends, accurately speaking, the deadly wound has not been completely healed just yet. It is almost there, okay? Since 1929, when Mussolini gave back the papacy their political power, and they became an independent state again, and now they've been meandering back into politics of the world, and they've been, the popes, the past popes have, you know, brought themselves and in the institution back into harmony, into good light with the other prime ministers and presidents and leaders of the world. Now you see, now you're starting to see that that deadly wound is almost healed, because when things go down, and the world starts getting bad, who do they always look to? Even recently with this whole Ukraine and Russia thing, who do they reach out to try to bring unity? And the Pope. Isn't that interesting? Yeah. Napoleon wasn't going to have that. He goes on to say in Revelation chapter 13, verse 14, and he... This is the second beast, the United States, deceives those who dwell on the earth by those signs which he was granted to do in the sight of the beast, telling those who dwell on the earth to make an image to the beast who was wounded by the sword and lived. By the way, do you know the United States has become and is becoming a direct image of Rome? I mean, of course, figuratively, spiritually for sure, but even literally in a lot of sense, if you've ever been to Washington, D.C., you don't feel like you're in Washington. You don't feel like you're in America when you're in Washington, D.C. Just go walk the streets of downtown or the historic town of D.C. All of the architecture, all of the building, it's like you're in Rome. It's all Roman architecture. Even down to the most important, what they consider the most important political building in this nation. It's the Capitol. Has anybody ever been to the Capitol? Have you ever seen the Capitol building? You know what it looks like, an almost a direct replica of? St. Peter's Basilica in Rome. It's quite interesting that in Rome, when the Pope, you know, you see those videos of the Pope, you know, in Rome, he'll come out on the little upper balcony of St. Peter's Basilica there. He'll come out on the upper little balcony, and all of the people are in that courtyard. But facing forward where the Pope is speaking from that high and lifted up balcony, facing forward, out there in the middle of the courtyard is this giant obelisk that's sticking straight up in the sky. Did you know on the west side of the Capitol building is what we call the Mall of America? The Mall of America is that big, wide open strip of land, beautiful green grass, where Martin Luther King Jr. gave his famous I Had a Dream speech, and you see just the hundreds of thousands of people out there in that open. That's the Mall of America. But what's interesting is when you step out on the west side of the Capitol building and you look straight out across there, guess what's standing up right in front? The Washington Monument, which happens to be a giant obelisk. We have literally built an image to the beast. I even find it interesting that... oh, man, you're getting me now. I find it interesting. I don't know if you guys remember this. Do you remember when Pope Francis came to the United States back in 2015? Some of you might remember that. Some of you may not. Every time we elect a new president, this has been every president... Just think of a president, every president, maybe with the exception of the first couple, every time the new elected president of the United States is inaugurated into office, it's always done from the lower foundational platform on the west side of the Capitol building facing the obelisk. Okay? The lower platform. Now, we're talking about the president of the United States. But when Pope Francis came to America... You would expect that when he would do his addressing to the American people, that they would bring him also down near and around that lower platform on the west side of the Capitol building. Now, see, if you look up at the Capitol building, there's a balcony. And the Pope decided to address the American people from the high and lifted up balcony, which no president has ever done. What does that tell you? What kind of message does that send? That you decide to address a people in a country where not even the leader of that country addresses them. What is that saying? Notice, he was granted power to give breath to the image of the beast, and the image of the beast should both speak and cause as many would not worship the image of the beast to be killed. When you get to the point where you don't accept the America that has turned into Rome, the oppressiveness of it, there will be those who will stand against it, and they will lose their life because of it. And you can't no one convince me for one second that the United States and the papacy does not have some kind of secret alliance. Because every past living president since Ford has had some type of ongoing relationship and secret meetings with the Vatican over the years. Even as recent as Barack Obama having private meetings, Trump having private meetings, and of course now your current president, Mr. Biden, has had private meetings with the Pope in the Vatican. Isn't it interesting that the Pope never comes to America to have private meetings with our president? Our president always goes to him. There's something there, my friends. I think that there's something there to tell us that just what God has said in His Word is unfolding just the way He said it would unfold. That the beast, the first beast of Revelation, all the world would wonder after it. That he has special relationships with the leaders of the world. Remember? What does it say? What does it say? What does it say in Revelation 17, verse 1 and 2? What does it say there? Go with me there. Revelation 17, verses 1 and 2. What does it say? Woo! Tell me if this isn't prophecy come true. Then one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls came and talked with these, saying, "Come, I will show you the judgment of the great harlot who sits on many waters, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth were made drunk with the wine of her fornication." Do we see the leaders and the kings of the earth having a special relationship with this papal system? My friends, it's happening. America is gradually turning into an image of Rome. And these are just more signs that Jesus said, when you see these things coming and you see them unfolding, know that my coming is near, even at the door. You know, many people might be thinking that the power, the ultimate power of this country, lies within the Congress or lies within the presidency. But that's not the case. You see, at the end of the day, when the president and Congress can't get along and can't make things happen, the ultimate and final judgment goes to nine people who hold the highest authority in our government. And that, of course, would be the nine Supreme Court justices. And you know, I remember I read from you, I think it was it Patrick Henry, who says we have a responsibility to elect Christian leaders for our country? Well, there are, some of them are Christian, for sure. But it's quite interesting to me that 50, 60, 70 years ago, and even before, if you were Catholic in this nation, you were persecuted. And what I mean by that is you were looked down upon. Now, I don't agree with that. Again, I'm not supporting the idea of persecuting anyone. That's not right. It's not of God. But nonetheless, history shows that if, according to 50, 60, 70 years ago, if you were a Catholic in this nation, you were looked down upon, you were frowned upon. Because again, when the founders came over, the Puritans came over, and all of these people came over from Western Europe, they were fleeing Europe to come here to do what? They were, for freedom of worship, they were fleeing Roman persecution. So for many years, yes, there were Catholics in this nation, many Catholics, but you were looked down upon and frowned upon by the majority if you were Catholic. Hence the reason why 70% in 1955 were Protestant, only 22% Catholic. And again, until John F. Kennedy, there really was no such thing as Catholics really playing a major leadership role in this country. And for sure, the elected officials for the majority of the time in this country, you wouldn't find a Catholic sitting on the most powerful legislative body in this nation. But you are looking at your current 9 Supreme Court justices. Seven of them are Catholic, and 2 of them are Jewish. There's not one Protestant that sits on your most powerful legislative body in the government. And the reason why we make this such a big deal, because Bible prophecy goes on to say in verse 16, it says, he, that is the second beast, the United States, causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, or free and slave, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their forehead, and that no one may buy or sell except he who has the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. That is forced legislative worship. And prophecy says that this nation, speaking as a dragon, that its leaders will bring about legislation that will bring about the mark of the beast and force its inhabitants to make a decision to comply or to rebel and receive the consequences. That sets us up for tonight. Because, my friends, this nation has went into full beast mode. The mark of the beast is coming quick. And that's what we're going to be talking about tonight at 7 p.m. That's why I know every single one of you are coming back tonight at 7 p.m. I know you're not going to go home and stay home. You're going to come right back here, aren't you? Yeah, some of you are like, you just don't know. I'm not coming back. Well, I'm going to pray that the Holy Spirit harasses you in all kinds of ways until you come back tonight at 7 p.m. It's going to be a great message. It's going to be, even though the mark of the beast tends to have a negative context, my friends, I promise you by the end of this message tonight, we're going to be encouraged knowing that we have a bright future ahead of us. If we remain in Christ Jesus, if we remain abiding in Jesus Christ, we have nothing to fear. We have nothing to fear. We don't have to fear where this nation is going. We don't have to fear any legislation. We don't have to fear any persecution or oppression, because we serve the God of the universe who holds life and death and everything else in his hands. And so put your trust in Jesus. Don't fear for what's happening and what's coming, because if you know Jesus, you have nothing to fear. Amen? Amen. I'm going to ask you to stand at this time. We're going to have a prayer, and then I'm going to turn it over to Pastor Tesh. Father in heaven, we praise you, God, for this beautiful, wonderful day you've given us. We thank you, Lord, for the message that confirms to us, Lord, that even though we're living in a nation that has went full beast mode, Lord, we know that you are still among your people and that you have a people who are following you, who are abiding in you, who are seeking you every single day. Lord, open our eyes. Help us to know the times, see the times that we're living in, and to prepare while we have a chance. We praise you, Lord, and thank you for your love, your grace, your mercy, and your patience on us, Lord. And we ask this in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Amen.
Please take your hymnal.